I'm Neal Kleiman. I'm chief of the section of interventional cardiology within the Department of Cardiology at Houston Methodist Hospital. And I'm going to talk to you about some of the things we're doing within our structural heart division. We've become a very busy division. We do several hundred TAVRs per year. We do a large variety of mitral and tricuspid valve interventions and clinical trials as well. We've published a good deal in these areas, but I'd like to focus today on one of the emerging areas in transcatheter treatment of patients with aortic valve disease. Now look, if you have followed the field at all, you know that TAVR has really taken off. It's become very popular. You probably know from the TVT registry in the United States that in 2019, TAVR overtook SAVR as the primary means of aortic valve replacement. So you probably know by now that TAVR has overtaken SAVR in popularity. As of the end of 2023, we have done more than 100,000 TAVRs compared with about 63,000 SAVRs. And the number of sites performing TAVR has exceeded 800. Nearly all those procedures have been performed for aortic valve stenosis, and that leaves untreated patients with aortic valve regurgitation, which up till very, very recently has been exclusively the surgical domain. Now, there are a couple of things we need to talk about for aortic regurgitation. It's not as commonly seen as aortic stenosis. It's usually not as dramatic until it reaches its very end stages, but it's still fairly prevalent. 4.5% of patients over age 65 have aortic regurgitation to some degree. Guidelines for replacement of the aortic valve in patients with AR are really, so far, pretty straightforward, but they're based entirely on the surgical experience. And those are class one, patients with severe AR who have either symptoms or a depressed left ventricular ejection fraction. Class 2A, patients who've got evidence of an increase in end systolic volume, that is dilation of the ventricle seen in systole. Class 2B, those whom you followed and who have progressive LV dilation. It's important to keep in mind that the two-year mortality of patients with aortic regurgitation is not negligible. So for patients with mild AR, it's about 7.5% or 7%. And for patients with severe AR, it exceeds 15%. At 5 years for severe AR, the mortality for untreated regurgitation is 75%. So it's serious business. And some risk factors for mortality have been identified. This is from a study by Philippe Généroux. And you know, most of this is common sense, things you'd expect to predict mortality. But what's important is, just as we learned a decade ago with aortic stenosis, the frequency of untreated, severe, symptomatic aortic regurgitation is somewhere between 50 and 75%. So pretty high. Probably not too different than what we originally learned with severe aortic stenosis. And similarly, it's likely that many of these patients shouldn't be treated because of severe underlying comorbidities, limited short-term survival, etc. So look, as you probably know, if you follow the field or if you don't follow the field, this just reiterates what you probably ought to know. In the U.S., there are three commercially available TAVR valves. This unfortunately shows an older version of the core valve that doesn't show the external wrap. This is an Edwards Sapien valve, and all the way on your right is a Portico Navitor valve. Now, these valves are designed for aortic stenosis, but there are certain challenges with aortic regurgitation. And if you think about it, these valves can be used for that indication. They are far from optimal for it. And the challenges are threefold. Number one, patients with aortic regurgitation generally have a dilated aortic annulus. So these valves may not be large enough to seat appropriately and seal in that location. Number two, The aortic root and ascending aorta are frequently enlarged, so the long frame valves may not be able to anchor in the ascending aorta. And number three, most important, annular and valvular calcification are either minimal or absent. And as you know, if you're in the TAVR world, calcium's your friend when you have enough to provide friction to anchor a valve into place. And it's also your enemy when there's too much calcium to prevent you from expanding the valve adequately. Now, the latter is probably not much of an issue in aortic regurgitation, but the ability or inability to anchor a valve appropriately is a limitation of any of these three valves. As I've said, they can be used for aortic regurgitation, but the results are really suboptimal, and putting this in a regurgitant lesion is really a struggle. So two valves dedicated for aortic regurgitation have been developed. And frankly, I wish I were smart enough to have developed these myself, but I'm not. The Jena valve and the J valve. And what you can see when you look at these is that unlike the valves I've shown you, these valves have locator shown here on the Jena valve and here on the J valve. And as these valves expand, these locator prongs extrude and are designed to fit between the native leaflets and the wall of the aortic root. So actually during diastole, as blood flows toward the aortic valve and the aortic valve is closed, these locators anchor the valves into the appropriate location. Now, just last month, our group published a meta-analysis in JACC Interventions comparing use of these new dedicated valves, which are still investigational, versus approved valves for the treatment specifically of pure aortic regurgitation. So we looked at 34 studies in more than 2,100 patients, and we were not surprised by the findings. Device success, 93% in the dedicated valves versus 82% in the currently available valves. 30-day mortality, again, significantly lower with dedicated valves. And residual aortic regurgitation, moderate or greater, 4% with dedicated valves versus 10% with the approved valves. So we're currently in the investigation of two of these valves, the Jena valve and its cousin, the J valve. So this is a patient in whom we implanted a Jena valve. And what you can see is a guiding aortic root injection. And you can see this is a coplanar view. So we see, number one, there's a tremendous amount of aortic regurgitation. You can see this ventricle fill very robustly, and you can see the three coronary cusps. Now, what I show you in the next frame is that we've brought the valve up through the dedicated sheath. This is the compressed valve, and this is the way it's placed in the aortic root. Now what I'll show you is the process of the valve as it's deployed. So what you can see is that as we release the valve, and this is done in stages, the locator prongs come out. Most of these are done under general anesthesia with TEE guidance. And we have to take a good deal of care to make sure that the locator prongs are in the correct position. As with every valve, there is a learning curve. And initially, we had a good deal of difficulty ascertaining that the prongs were in the right place. And truthfully, you really have to get all of the prongs into the right location, that is, three prongs into the coronary cusps, to make sure that the valve sits symmetrically and won't move. And in fact, that's what we're doing here. And you can see we've got a catheter pointed at the left coronary artery, and I think you see it, Phil, here. Yeah, in this case, not necessarily, but we do this also to cannulate the left and make sure that the valve and the locators are in the correct position. And then once we've achieved that, we advance the catheter so that the locators are now at the base of the cusps, and we then release the valve itself within its frame. So the locator keeps the frame of the valve in place so that when the functional part of the valve is released, it sits in one position and stays there. This is our final valve deployment. I think you can see the locator cusps, the locator prongs shown here and here. Here's another patient we did, and this is a need that we're certainly becoming more aware of. This is a patient with a left ventricular assist device. You can see it implanted in the LV apex here. This patient developed severe aortic regurgitation after the device had been implanted. And this is a patient with a virgin aortic valve, a relatively young patient with a healthy aortic root, but whose valve has become regurgitant while the device is implanted. And so this patient had pretty severe heart failure, and this is an implant that we did in this patient. So this is a growing need, and there's now a registry of patients who've got aortic regurgitation in the presence of an LVAD, and we're implanting patients in that situation. So we're now very heavily involved in this clinical trial. We're looking at patients with pure aortic regurgitation. We're looking at patients with ventricular assist devices and aortic regurgitation. And we're entering a trial in addition that compares implantation of this valve with surgical replacement of the valve, just as we did once we advanced in the TAVR for aortic stenosis world. So I've shown you one of the fields in which we're very interested, become very involved. I hope I've sparked your interest, and I hope I've at least introduced you to this field. Thank you.